Everyone to this restream, audio was broken. So for those who tuned in now in this stream, I made the earlier video. I was curious about the ASUS RGB lighting here, and I thought displaying CPU load would be cool. I tried in the lunch break some Rust code. I patched the kernel, also the Linux kernel. And now let's put here quickly some CPU load. For you, we're compiling LVM, actually what I'm showing here, compiling LVM, and you see that it starts out with just blue, and then I mapped the cores to the 7 LEDs. Of course, we have 8 cores, 16 threads, and 7 LEDs. So as more as the cores get loaded with the CPU, those LEDs of those matching cores will be red, otherwise they start out as just a little bit blue and all individually. And I thought this is pretty cool. Of course, it's not as much visible as it is in real life. We could also zoom in here. So actually zoomed in, you see it looks slightly more cool, I guess. Anyway, I also wish, as I said, slightly stupid on the motherboard, in my opinion, and it would make more sense visible on the case, like I've done in old-fashioned times. But for these details, you can see the other live stream. And now I wanted to show you how I've done this, because the original code was only some demo application from someone, I guess. And that is this one. Also to show you a little bit of Rust. So Aura controller, this one, Rust file, because as much as I criticize Rust, I thought it's only fair if I actually try to work a little bit with this Rust code. So this is a controller implementation here in Rust that we love here so much on this channel. And I took a look here because, as I said in the earlier live stream, this lunch break, it only supports setting one color, which is of course not very flexible or feature rich or whatever. So this method would be this here, public function set colors, some mutable self and color. So this is an argument with a type pointer reference to some U8 array and returning some Aura result. It's checking already the colors array, so this is this array here, the U8 array, unsigned integer, 8-bit integer. And if the length is not equal to the LED count multiplied by 3, it's already returning here some error. So I quickly realized it supports setting or sending all those color values to the 7 LEDs of the hardware. Just actually so much to showing this. Getting late after this Pulse Audio YouTube live stream fail. So yeah, now you see it. And what it's doing, so you see here, it is actually passing all those values down to the hardware. And I only had to modify here the main function for this to actually have any effect and send more than one color. Also, yeah, a little bit wide. Of course, it's some proof of concept test application from someone or some testbed, some Rust learning curve or something. Why they did not implement passing down all the colors in the first place, I don't know, after going all the way of Rust example program. So what it's further doing here before going to the main function is it's swizzling here the colors, mixing these colors together, likely because it's maybe first all RGB, first all red values, because the colors come in here. And this, it's swizzling these colors here. You see here iterating for I from 0 to length divided by 3. And then swapping here indexed multiplied by I plus 1 and I plus 2. So a little bit not super readable, but I guess swapping all the red values first and all the red, blue and green values, I suppose. But correct me if I'm wrong. And yeah, then sending this down here to the I2C bus with some write register 20, 21, 25 here, some static mode, otherwise it's doing some fancy animation. And then sending here, where is even the buffer somewhere, find the number of LEDs. Somewhere must the buffer, or is it, where is it writing the, here. So for its set colors. Oh, this is initialize. Sorry, I scrolled over this. So initialize sets this to static colors, and here it's sending the buffer like write register bytes from assert upload index 1 or something. Anyway, so we want to set more than one color, and that is happening in the main function, and that is here. So using this extern create I square C device using standard env and iter, these are these crates that are loaded, fetched from the cloud, from all this fancy auto magic stuff. And here's some good old fashioned constants, unsigned 32-bit. These are some good old fashioned Intel or x86 I/O port addresses. So this is not fancy modern memory map, but old-fashioned I/O ports, just like the VGA port and stuff. And I think it's actually so. I don't think it's bit banging those here. I think this is only using this to load a module or something here anyway, because normally you should not access them directly in modern operating systems anyway. So then it's also having here some constants for those register values here from the I2C, from the connected LED controller here, from this Aura. And what it is doing here is, you see here, it's defining some argument vector array here. This let is something like local variable, and the type is automatic here. Usually, at least. And so here it is using the environment arguments, skipping one and taking three, collect this, as people pointed out in the audience earlier, making a copy of those or something, because what the skip is skipping the program argument, just like in C++, where the first argument would be your program name. So it's skipping this and then taking three, so it could still like be empty or just one value. So it's checking the copied value here of this collect slightly. Yeah, if you know what this collect is, cheesecake said earlier, this is returning some vector. However, I would think it would already return a vector, so it's not really entirely clear, some deep copy or something this is doing. Maybe not. Anyway, so it's checking here that the argument is 3, so just RGB, and it's not accepting more values. If you pass in here 20 values, they will just be skipped, because it's skipping 1 and taking 3. So if you supply it 70 values or any amount more than 3, it's just skipping them. And then it's instantiating this find SMB bus and I2C adapters from this path, and then base address of this find. So it's not bit banging this directly, it's just checking from sysfs or something that it's on those base address, because we also have some I2C controller for the AMD AMD or NVIDIA, but of course we have AMD graphics and temperature sensors of the IT87 temperature and sensor controllers. So comments in the audience. It's returning, so args is returning an iterator. Okay, so let's size. So see, so okay, this is so this is probably then, well, the name I've anyway find stupid. It would be more logically if this is called like copy or something, or but okay, maybe okay, copy would copy of an iterator. Okay, so I understand that that's an iterator. It's the iterator is like skipping one iteration step and then like narrowing down the iteration to three values, I guess, to the iteration range of from one to three inclusive, and then collect is likely like collecting those values. Then I guess like okay, then I collect at least. Thanks for that tip. That we learn here Rust together, and you also see I've done this here in 30 minutes. Actually, most of the time took writing some more code that I've not written in Rust, because comments in the audience, collect converts iterator. Yeah, that's what I just said, I guess. I hope that this made sense. So then actually the code, I'm again not really sure why this person has done it like this, because the code is like literally all here. Maybe he was satisfied with the result, because here you see they are repeating this color value. So here when eventually this I2C controller is found here on the motherboard, on the Linux interfacing side, then it's instantiating and iterating over all those controllers. And when it has a controller here for all the controllers in controller iterators mutable, then it is creating here a new vector and repeating all those color values. So we have only one set of color values, RGB, for one LED, but we have seven. So here it is actually, the code is copying, repeating this here iterator repeat from colors, take total LED count, clone, flatten, collect. So this is again like similar there at the beginning in this iteration range, taking those LED count, cloning, flattening, and flattening because it is a set of three, I guess. So you would have had multiple in this vector, you would have like three values, like sub vectors, multiple vectors. So flattening, I assume, is then creating instead of seven vectors with three values, creating one vector with 3 × 7, so 21 values, and again collecting those, returning this in an array vector, and then calling the vector. So what I've done, so you would think modifying this is relatively easy. Modifying this is here in my trusty Emacs buffer, and so the main function, I had to move this a little bit around because I couldn't do this earlier if we want to check the number of arguments, because if we do not check the number of arguments, we will get an error later on anyway. So I removed all the argument parsing here in the beginning. That would be all this argument parsing here. I removed this argument parsing. Or is this also? Anyway, then I only left this as a bus. I only show you this in the browser window because it's nicer formatted. I think it's in black and white. My Emacs is so old, it doesn't have Rust highlighting. So, and then I inserted, it's a little bit dirty, quick and dirty, but I wanted to get this to work. I commented out here this color repeating stuff and instead have the argument parsing here. So each time, oops, also not random clicking, each time we iterate over all the controllers and each time we find a controller, we do the argument parsing here just like we had, but instead of taking three, we take three multiplied by the controller, total LED count collected. And only if it's less than three, we error out, whatever. Actually, we could also error out if it's unequal three multiplied by controller LED count, but whatever. And unsurprisingly, this works. As you see, we can drive all those LEDs individually. Now we only had to write code to do this in, to read the CPU count. That I have done in Lua because it's just so much faster, in my opinion. Writing this in Rust or C++ would be not only much more error prone, but also take longer. So you also see here a quick dive into Lua. If you've never seen this, it's a little bit like JavaScript dynamically typed. If you don't use just-in-time compiler interpreted, so I have your read file function that is doing IO open on the file name here. I only have here some matching stuff that you see in a second. What we have to do is the CPU count, as the CPU load is in proc. Nah, come on. Proc, not CPU info, proc stat. That is one big file with a lot of stuff, starting with the CPU load, like user, system idle, IO wait, interrupt wait, something, stolen, guest, and something. So we need to parse this as quickly and dirty as possible, and then all the interrupts and something that all we don't need. This is what I use this match for. So we parse this file as long as this leading identifier matches. So I match this with CPU and skip parsing as soon as there's non-CPU stuff. So this is what I have this match for. This is just an optimization. You wouldn't need to do this, but I thought, why pass here 20 lines of interrupt stuff that we don't need. Then you see even in Lua, you have some iteration stuff. We have here some stats. It's all our status here for L, for line, L in all this file lines, just an iterator like you have also in Rust similar. Then values and keys. The keys which I initialize here to an empty array. And then we match here the whole line, all the non, this is here string matching. This is why exactly why I've done this in Lua and not in Rust or C++, because it's just here some error, some completely safe, not off by one, under overrun string matching here, matching all non-spaces here, percent capital S, all of them always space limited. And if we have not a key, then because I use this here as index into this like hash table, like key value pairs in this dictionary. And if it's the first thing, if we don't have, if we have, usually I like to, if not yet a key, maybe I write this here. You see, if I try to explain this, maybe also a good thing to try to explain your codes and you see. So if we do not yet have a key for this line, the key is here CPU 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If not yet a key, then assign the key. Otherwise, add this here all to the value array that we started here empty. And then if this matched, if the key matches, if we have a match to skip on, to drop out early, and if this key matches our match that we want to match, then if it does not match, then we break out here. Otherwise, we collect the stats and then close the file just to be nice. And yeah, I copied this from another file. We don't really need this. It's just be nice to the garbage collector, but doesn't really have much effect anyway. Return the stats. Then I want to, this is an argument you see here, similar arguments handling, argument first argument to execute. I pass in here, as you see, it's running here. So this is what I pass in here, the Borrelius target debug something here to execute with all our LED values. And what we need to do is, because this are the total count, it's a little bit Unix kind of stupid. So this is a total count since system boot of all the CPUs. So we actually need to differentiate all those values here. This is why this is a little bit more code than you would expect. You would expect you read a file and you get the CPU load. No, you read the file and this is a total amount of ticks of your scheduler, of your operating system since boot. This is why we need to differentiate all those numbers. And for this here, you see while true, and here's also a local like let in Rust, but in Lua local variable, otherwise it would be global. Doesn't really matter in this use case, but just some nice style here of programming. So infinite loop here while true, read this stats, and then what I do here, so this is only because I want to merge with this stupid ASUS LEDs are only 7s and I have 16 threads here. This is why I merge every two of them together, the statistics here. So iterate from 0 to math huge number. You could also type this something, but this is here like infinity, so whatever. And iterate in this for loop always with a step of 2. Then we have, ideally, as I write here, to do check dynamically. So ideally, we would want to determine the CPU's thread and core mapping dynamically from this FS. But for the quick evening test here, that's fine for me here. And then we have two rows here that we have CPU 0 and like CPU I and I plus 1, two rows, like in a database. If we don't have any rows left, because we iterate here from 0 to infinity, if we don't have any rows left, break out here. Otherwise, actually we could, usually I format this like this, I guess. Yeah, this is only debugging. This, of course, goes away here also. Now I pressed maybe the wrong button. Let's see. Then we merge those rows. So we iterate for I, V in integer pairs. This is an integer array, or like, because these are dictionaries, like key value pairs, but old fashioned Lua has an optimization for arrays, like integer indexed array parts. This is otherwise it would be pairs, and iPairs is integer indexed array pairs. But the modern Lua wants to get away with this, but I still like this. So integer pairs are like good old-fashioned arrays, and here we just add those rows together. Row for all those integer values, like array values, we have here a local for local variables in Lua. I like to use underscore just for some quick and dirty local variable. And so I sum all those two rows together to merge our two threads of one core together for our stupidly missing leads there. And then I store this in stats2. You see statistics2, empty dictionary, empty. Actually, in Lua, everything is a table, so empty table here. And then we add the CPUs there into this table, merging the threads into cores. And then if we have a last value, because the first time we rerun this, we don't have any statistics. So the first time this will be nil, and we will store the last values, our statistics too, that we merge together in the last value, and then we sleep for 1 second. The second time we come along here, we have a last value, so we can differentiate this two sets of tables. I've done this here quick and dirty. I'm sure in Rust you can do this with amazing iterators, but you can also open code this like this in Lua for you to learn if you're not in programming. You see also, I think in my opinion, Lua is a pretty amazing and simple language to get into if you're not yet into programming. It's a little bit JavaScript, it's a little bit like JavaScript, just without all the fancy esoteric features. It has less exceptions and is much simpler, and you can also use it for embedded stuff. And even Adobe Lightroom used this to writing the whole Adobe Lightroom application, or even World of Warcraft. So basically every second game is using Lua as internal scripting language. So what we do here for differentiation, so CLI is our command line that we generate here with all our LED numbers. So we are generating a command line with 21 RGB values to call to execute this Rust program. And yes, of course, ideally next step I would write this I2C stuff here in my Lua or C++ or something, because still not yet the greatest fan. I only wanted to have this LED animated LED CPU load working. So quickly for core in rows of our last, this is our last cached value of last run that we need to create the difference values from. So for the core, so we have a table, multiple tables, and with multiple rows for each core. So for each core and each of those array rows from the last time and the new run. So we have an old row and a new row. Could also name this n row, but whatever. Just wanted to get this quickly working. We also need a total. So while differentiating this, is easy, just for all values for I, v, index and value. I like for this small mathematics stuff, I like to use I for integer, index, and k for keys, and v for values in all these integer pairs of this row. And we have a second row, so this is the current last row and the new row. Yeah, maybe it's better. Let me know, do you like this n row for new row? It's always, you realize that naming is maybe not ideal if you try to explain it to someone else. So we differentiate this, differentiating meaning SS is a total wall clock time since power on. We need to compute this here since the last second. And this is a difference of CPU load spent in user space, kernel, interrupt handling, IO, wait, and so on. So this is our actual time. And to optimize this a little bit, because we need the total sum for the percentage, I already create a total sum of CPU ticks spent in the scheduler for this stuff. Otherwise, you would need to iterate this again for begin to end, sum this up. So just a tiny optimization. Then we have the idle time. The idle time is this timing values here in the statistics are user nice, system idle, IO wait, IRQ, soft IRQ, steal, guest, and guest nice. So we have the total, we have the idle. So the idle is the entry 4 in this array that we differentiated here. And so then idle is row, the value 4 of total is the idle time. And then we can directly compute the RGB values. Initially, I had here, so blue, so I wanted idle, blue should be idle, I thought. Sounds nice to me. This is why, so these values are 0 to 255. This is why I have here 255. And because Lua is having all numbers usually in floating point, just like usually in JavaScript or something, this is why we need to round this here. And floor, I cached this here, local floor equals mess floor. Otherwise, if we don't cache this, Lua is not as optimized. If you don't have a just-in-time compiler, it would do here each time the lookup in the environment. This is why I cached here the floor function, just to be nice. And so if it's totally idle, like 100% idle, I saw 255 should be blue. We never have a green value, so that would be zero. And then as more as it is not idle, that value would directly be red. So if we are zero idle, this would be just the inverse, 255 minus the idle time zero. So, and not to round this here two times, again being nice to our naive and not as optimized language, directly use here integer values. And because the problem was with the blue is very bright, and then it was the bright was always shining very bluish, and because of this I scale blue here down very much, and for this I use a integer divide that you're, depending on your variant of Lua, you might or might not have an integer divide. I use an integer divide here with a backslash to scale this blue values down a lot. Otherwise it is extremely blue in the case there and you only see blue. Initially I was wondering is it working or not, because I only saw blue there. So this is why I'm scaling down blue so much. And then we add this text together in Lua text string addition is dot dot. So our existing command line concatenated this two spaces zero, just to have this nicely separated for me to read. Then concatenated with the red space green space blue value. And I just do a little bit optimization. If you write it like this, it works also, but it is slightly less optimal because it is expanding, concatenating the long string. Of course, it doesn't really make much of a difference on a Ryzen with the small strings, but theoretically it is slightly more optimal to create here the small string and then only concatenate it once to the longer string, otherwise slightly more expensive. If we have something to execute, if the user supplied here a value, arg1, then I print it here just for me for debugging. You see here's a print 34 and so on. Here are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 values. Of course, our not amazing ASUS RGB LEDs are not using the last value, because in our Rust code here, we only take LED count multiplied by 3 here. So the last set of values is unfortunately not used on this mainboard, but maybe yours has 8 LEDs, or maybe I solder more LEDs. It would also be more amazing if we actually have the LEDs here, like a B-box or something. We could also be fancy and install here like a huge LED matrix if we would have too much time and money and buy here hundreds of LEDs. Anyway, this is how you can quick and dirty in just some 30 minutes write your own glue stuff for LED animation. And would be interesting to learn from you in the comments, how much do you like Rust and Lua? What do you find?